you have searched me and known me. You discern my thoughts from far away. You searched out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Good morning. We are playing a bit of a game here, aren't we? This is guess where we are filming and what the furniture is. So feel free to put your guesses on the comments as to where, what room we're in and what the furniture is. So we're moving around trying to figure out where we are going to be. But welcome this morning. We've got a few announcements. One is food pantry needs. The current needs that Bill has listed are for detergent, cereal, fresh chicken or any fresh meat, hot dogs, cheese, and bottled water. So if you can help out with any of those, it would be greatly appreciated. This is going to be, this Sunday will be the last Sunday I'm in town until after a brief vacation. Lisa and I are going to take some day trips and get out for a little while. So we're still trying to figure out what next Sunday will look like. It'll probably be a different room with different furniture, but we'll figure something out. And Dick Kiever is going to be live with us. We are still continuing the live stuff. We are watching closely what is happening in the state of Virginia, and we are keeping that service as safe as we possibly can while we do try to gather together for a while. We try to keep it usually to about a half an hour, which is why sermons are getting shorter, because the live version, we are trying to keep folks in that room for less time so that their exposure to anything, should it be in the room, is reduced. So keep us in your prayers and let us know if there's anything you'd like to have announced during this time or anything else we can do. In the meantime, we come into the presence of the Lord God Almighty. Let us lift up our hearts and worship the Lord. Amen.
Please join in listening to hymn 341, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
Savior all the day long.
Continuing in the Gospel of Matthew, and we are dealing with the parable of the weeds among the wheat. And then this is a split parable. There's a parable and then an explanation. The parable comes in chapter 13, verses 24 through 30, and then the explanation comes in verses 36 through 43. And I'm going to split the sermon. So I'm going to read the parable first, and then we will move to the end later. So there will be a pause in the middle. The word of the Lord. Jesus put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field, but while everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And then the slaves of the householder came and said to him, "Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from?" He answered, "An enemy has done this." The slaves said to him, "Then do you want us to go and gather them?" But he replied, "No, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, 'Collect the weeds first and bind them into bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn.'" Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come again to your ancient word, seeking the inspiration of your living word. May your living word move in, through, and even in spite of the words of my mouth. In Jesus' name. Amen. The coveted position in here is the position of slave, which is not an easy position to see coveting, but they can identify. They know that there is good and bad. They want to do something for the master. They know that the master sowed the good into the field, and they know that somebody else must have sown the bad, and they want to do something. The role of servant is the role of one who can use their intellect to see what is wrong and use their resources to do something about it. And yet, the master cautions them. The master says to leave it in there, to leave the weeds in, because they may uproot the wheat when they pull. They don't know as much as they think they should. And the master cautions them to leave it in. Whenever I hear that, "leave it in," I go immediately to the middle of the last century and theologians writing in the time of World War II, wondering about the evil that was the Nazi regime. Could you leave that in? And writers like Reinhold Niebuhr and Dietrich Bonhoeffer are blunt about the fact that we live in a fallen world. And sometimes living in a fallen world means that we do have to uproot the tares. We are called to defend those who are defenseless. In our own time, surely, the weed of racism, the weeds of abuse, should be uprooted. But while these theologians are blunt about the fact that we live in a fallen world, and sometimes to be a follower of Christ means you have to come to the defense of others, even if that puts yourself in a position of sin. They are blunt about that, but they also understand what is being said in this parable. Reinhold Niebuhr says, "No virtuous act is quite as virtuous from the standpoint of our friend or foe as it is from our standpoint. Therefore, we must be saved in the final by the final form of love, which is forgiveness. No virtuous act is quite as virtuous from the standpoint of our friend or foe as it is from our standpoint. Our righteousness or sense of righteousness can become self-righteousness. And we can act out of that as much, if not more, than act out of our sense of justice for somebody being abused. And Niebuhr knew that. He cautioned against it. He saw that we could take it too far. We could judge too harshly, and we could uproot wheat as we yank tares. And Bonhoeffer was the same. He said the human conscience can become an adversary to God's will if the retreat into the ethical conflict is used as an excuse for a lack of obedience. We can become an adversary to God if we decide that the ethical conflict in which we are faced, with which we are faced, is so great that we can cease to be obedient to God. We can start to uproot wheat as we fight the tares. These theologians knew that. They knew the fallen world that we lived in. They knew the real issues that we faced, but they also knew that we could do real damage if we weren't careful. And yet Jesus takes it a step further. I'm going to continue reading verses 36 through 43. But keep in mind the coveted position of slave, the one who can discern, the one who can act on behalf of the master. Listen for the slave in the explanation. Then Jesus left the crowds and went into the house. And his disciples approached him, saying, "Explain to us the parable of weeds of the field." He answered, "The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one. And the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all evildoers. And they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father." Let anyone with ears listen. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. The servants aren't there. The slaves are not in the explanation. The reapers are there. They're the angels. The sower is there. The Son of Man. The enemy is there. The devil. The servants are not there. We may stand in this day and age able to discern the evil around us, able to discern the wheat and the tares. Maybe. Maybe we have been given that gift. But at the end of the age, at the end of the days, the only thing that there is children. Children of the kingdom, children of the evil one. There are no servants. There is no hierarchy. We are children of the one to whom we listen. Jesus emphasizes that when he ends that with, "Let anyone with ears listen." It's a throwback to the transfiguration. "This is my Son with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." We must never endeavor to be so righteous for justice that we stop listening to God, that we stop listening to Christ. Jesus promises us that all causes of sin will be removed. That means the causes of sin, of racism, of abuse, of oppression, of injustice, all of that will be removed by him, not by us. The servants are not in the explanation, but they are in the first part. The role is necessary. There are times we will be asked to be servants, for the justice of the Lord. But we must never cease to be children of God when we take that mantle on. That is who we will be at the end of the age. And so we must listen to him, even in the midst of conflict. Listen to Christ. Listen to the words of the one who forgives you, who calls you by name, and who promises you eternity. In Jesus' name.
Blessed are you.
Friends, the servants aren't in that last, in the explanation, but they are in the first one. There are times when we are called to stand against things that we know are evil, when people are being hurt. But we should do so cautiously and deliberately, understanding that at the end of the day, we are all going to be judged as children of God. There will be no hierarchy. And so, even as we are thrust by a sinful world into the need to be servants and look at wheat and tares, we do so knowing that we are saved by God, we are loved by God, and so are those we judge. Go now into the world and listen to God. Listen to the one who speaks to your heart and calls you to repentance as a child of God. And may the Lord remain between me and thee while we are apart each from the other. Amen.